was the independent producers who rose and introduced the features. The Motion Picture Patent Company, the fixedly conservative combine that included all of the principal early producers, that's Edison, Vitagraph, and Biograph, finally failed in their efforts to exert a monopoly through its patent claims and its attempts to control the manufacture of equipment and stock. Founded in 1908, the Trust, as it came to be known, consistently resisted longer films and stuck to the outright sale of prints through its distribution arm, General Film Company, established in 1910. With the increasing acceptance of the more expensive features, a rental system evolved whereby, after they had made the rounds of the theaters, the prints would return to the producers. By 1914 to 1915, the Trust was clearly being beaten by the amount and the quality of its competition. The independents were too numerous, aggressive, and ingenious. There simply was no way to keep them from producing and distributing films. By 1917, through court decisions in a series of antitrust suits, the Motion Picture Patents Company was declared legally dead. During those same years, partly as a result of an attempt by the independents to escape the legal harassment and goon squads of the Trust, the center of the production of movies shifted from New York to Southern California. From about 1907 to 1917, Chicago was also a production center, with three large Trust firms, S&A, Selig, and Kalem, located in Chicago. With the feature film as the staple commodity, with the former independents becoming the newly dominant powers as the old Trust companies faded away or were absorbed, and with Hollywood the production center and the distribution controlled out of New York, the model was established for industrial expansion for the next decade and beyond. The general lines followed were already standard in manufacturing, wholesaling, and retailing of other products. The movie industry had the same requirements as any industry, and the annual costs of production were enormous. As in its close contemporary, the automobile industry, for example. As far as manufacture was concerned, the motion picture automobile industries were both geographically centered near raw materials and sources of power, with specialized pools of labor developing around them. In fact, with the movie industry, much of its labor was imported from abroad. Detroit was within reach of its coal, oil, iron ore, and steel mills. Hollywood's distance from New York and proximity to asylum across the Mexican border were initially among its chief attractions to the independents who settled there. Later, Hollywood proved to have attributes similar to the raw materials and sources of power sought to in other industries. The extraordinary variety of California scenery meant that virtually any sort of location, mountain, desert, ocean, forest, rolling hills, could be duplicated within a few hundred miles of Los Angeles. In those days, when sunshine was still the principal source of illumination for movie making, even the interior scenes, Southern California had more of it than did the Eastern centers. Gigantic Hollywood studios became the equivalent of Detroit's River Rouge plant. Enormously expensive facilities and equipment constructed and assembled in both. Motion picture projection was standardized now throughout the world. Any change that required retooling invested vast sums of capital, and only economic crisis could induce this. The assembly line method devised by Henry Ford eventually would have an analog in the Hollywood production process. Tendencies in that direction were already manifest in the late 1910s. It was Thomas H. Ince who first functioned as a studio head, production supervisor, planning and overseeing an entire production program. He supervised the making of hundreds of films, developing especially the Western genre and its early star, William S. Hart, into a popularity that rivaled the melodramas of Griffith and the comedies of Sennett. In 1915, Ince joins Griffith and Sennett in the newly formed Triangle Film Corporation, named in honor of the three of them. When Ince left Triangle to form his own company, he built a big new studio at Culver City, which later became MGM Studios. The production methods that began with Ince would become standard Hollywood practice by the 1920s. This piecemeal assembly, especially the practice of shooting out of sequence, however efficient and economical, it tended to make the creative process disjointed and strained. The notion of separate specialists in charge of each of the many aspects of production seemed a bitter paradox to those who thought a work of art demanded by definition the absolute domination of a single personality. But there just wasn't enough individual genius around to supply the theaters with a steady and frequent change of bill. What generally resulted from this art by committee, as with American automobile manufacture, was a high level of standardized technical excellence. The problem was the mass-produced films came to look pretty much alike to the critical eye. A crucial problem for the motion picture industry thus became how to create the illusion of variety without fundamental differences involving wasteful experimentation and expense. One of the solutions was not unlike the development of the automobile types. We had the sport roadster, the family sedan, the offering of slightly different models each year. These evolved types of formula pictures came about. We had the woman's picture, the comedy, the action adventure, and cycles within each type, the vamp, the rural comedy, the war dramas. Technicians could become expert at a particular kind of filmmaking. One Western, for example, could effortlessly follow the pattern of another. Audiences always had the choice of going to one of the popular genres one week and to another the next, keeping their entertainment sufficiently varied to obscure the similarities within the limited spectrum. Then, too, the familiar had its own attractions. Repetition with variation is pleasurable. Nobody wanted a Western so different as to seem unlike a Western. Another device that kept the audiences coming back for more was the cultivation of the star personality. People would go again and again to see Mary Pickford, Mabel Normand, Charlie Chaplin, or Douglas Fairbanks, just to be in their screen presence for an hour and a half on a Friday night. In this case, too, the fans didn't want radical innovation any more than the producers did. They enjoyed their favorite vehicles, carefully tailored to exploit their appeal. The stars commanded an automatic audience. As long as the range extended from femme fatale, Theda Bara, to melodrama heroine, Pauline Frederick, from robust comic, John Bunny, to matinee idol, Francis X. Bushman, what more could be asked? Aspiring performers patterned themselves or were patterned along the lines of the already established so that even the individuality of personality could be fitted into the existing grooves. Finally, the whole enterprise was enveloped in an unprecedented amount of promotion and advertising designed to whip up audience expectations. Each film, even if essentially indistinguishable from others preceding it, was presented as the most spectacular, the most action-packed, the funniest, the most heartwarming. In short, as something not to be missed. Press agents soon encompassed the stars' lives off-screen as well as on, and made them into demigods whose mythological existence commanded constant attendance and unswerving devotion. That was how the system came to work. By the end of the first quarter of the century, film production, which had begun in a tar paper shack or literally done on the street, had moved into large permanent studios clustered for the most part around Los Angeles. Distribution initially was a simple and direct affair. The producers sold prints of films outright to those showing them at so much per foot, like cordwood, 10 cents per foot. or $100 per reel was common, regardless of the quality of the entertainment. As audiences tired of seeing the same films over again, it occurred to someone to set up an exchange whereby exhibitors could trade in their prints and, for a small fee for the service, obtain used prints of different films from other exhibitors. With increased competition among producers and discrimination on the part of the public, the practice of rental instead of sale gradually evolved. Producers then received a share of the actual box office drawing power of their films, greater for the more attractive and expensive, less for the others. This practice made for one of the singularities of the industry. The product is not bought or sold. Customers merely pay to spend some time looking at it. The retailers, exhibitors, return a share of that income to the wholesalers, distributors, who in turn subtract their expenses and profits and pass the remainder on to the manufacturers or the producers. Exhibition, which had started as part of vaudeville programs, began to take place in Nickelodeons in 1905, when films became longer and more of them narrative. Named for the price of admission, these first movie houses characteristically were converted storefronts, perhaps with chairs rented from a local funeral parlor. The Nickelodeon showed continuous programs of assorted short films. The enormously successful The Great Train Robbery opened many of them. The arrival of features and the increasing popularity of film, former stage theaters were converted for motion picture exhibition. The big era of showing movies in the town's opera house and competing with stage road shows dates from 1913 to 1916. At that time, there were perhaps as many as 28,000 movie theaters of all types in the United States. A new and more pretentious type of screen theater was initiated in 1914 with the opening of The Strand on Broadway, soon to be followed by others with equal ambitions. Widespread construction of theaters designed especially for movies did not occur, however, until the 1920s. By the time World War I ended, in late 1918, the American film had achieved all the essentials necessary to ensure its success in the art industry. One, a steady flow of features accompanied by shorts, especially by popular comedies. Two, a national distribution in which prints circulated out of regional exchanges within a rental system and permitted the income to flow back through exhibitors and distributors to producers. And finally, theaters gradually being formed into chains by enterprising exhibitors, accommodating larger and more demanding audiences, paying higher prices. These fundamentals extended to an international scale and gave the United States its lead in the conquest of the world screen. Once the war was over, growth of the medium could resume unimpeded by national boundaries.